We'll continue our study of conversion sequences and of limits with some more theoretical results. So far we have seen the main definitions of conversions and the first properties. We have seen some examples, computed some limits. And now in the largest part of the remainder of the section, I want to investigate the behavior of limits and to establish some rules of how to compute with limits that we will later on need to really determine many examples using those simple rules. So far, next thing will be quite theoretical, but don't worry, there will be some examples, and in the next section I'm also happy to give some additional examples, but we'll come to that. So now there's a bit more theory. So first of all, we have seen limits and we have seen examples, but we haven't studied so far how they behave with respect to the algebraic operations that we consider. Namely, consider a sequence either in R or in C, so let K be equal to R or K equal to C. And assume we have two conversion sequences, so an, n and n, bn, n and n, b convergent sequences. Oops, convergent sequences. And we give names to the limits, namely a should be the limit of an and b the limit of bn. Okay, so how do they behave with respect to our addition and multiplication operations? So first of all, if we take the sum of the two sequences, so an plus bn, and consider this as a sequence, so the nth element is just the sum of the two nth elements of the sequences we had before, then this converges, and it turns out the limit of the sum is the sum of the limits. So the limit n to infinity of the sum an plus bn is simply a plus b. So limits behave well with respect to sums. Second part, if we multiply with some constants, say for each element c and k, if we take the sequence c times an, so we just multiply every element of the sequence by the same factor, then like from our notion of convergence or from our intuition, we should just get the product of the limit before with c, and this is precisely what we get. So this sequence converges and the limit n to infinity of c times an, so I just draw some brackets to make a parenthesis to make it clear here. So this is simply c times a. Okay, we will also study products of two sequences later, so you might now ask what happens if we study an times bn. It's a bit more complicated, but I mean the behavior is the same, but the proof is a bit more complicated, so we will see this later on. Okay, so this is the first basic thing, and this we will prove explicitly. Okay, we start like we always start when converging. We take some epsilon bigger than zero, and remember from the definition of convergence, we need to find some n zero such that all terms of the sum of this an plus bn are epsilon close to this a plus b in the sense that we had before. So up from a certain n zero on. And this is precisely what we get. Namely, we first of all use the convergence behavior of an and bn itself. Namely, we know if we have some epsilon, there exists values such that an and bn are close, epsilon close to their limits. And not only that, we make a slight difference. So we have n1, n2 in n, such that an minus a to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon over 2. Okay, you might now ask why in the world is he doing this? We will see this in a bit. So that this holds for every n bigger than or equal to n1. I mean, we just, instead of epsilon, we can just take this as our new epsilon and find the appropriate n1. This is what we're doing here. And the same we can do for the b's. Namely, we have this n2 such that bn minus b to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon over 2 for all n, at least n2. Okay, so of course we can do this. The question is why, and this is always kind of the When you first see these calculus proofs, it often happens that you take something to be smaller than epsilon over blah, 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 something very complicated. And the only reason is afterwards because it works. Because in our computation that's come, you will see that this kind of magically adds up to give the right result. And this is what we see. So you kind of need to see this a few times to get the idea of it. And to really, and so I really recommend to study these proofs explicitly so you understand how to work with these epsilons. Namely, when we have this, so we need to study the sum. And for the sum, we now put n0 to be the biggest of the two numbers, n1 and n2. Of course, they don't have anything to do with each other because it's just separate sequences. So we just take the maximum of n1 and n2. Then, for all n bigger than or equal to n0, we get the following. So we want to estimate an plus bn minus the sum of the limits, so minus a plus b to the absolute value. Reordering these terms, this is the same as an minus a plus bn minus b. Of course, we don't need these parentheses, but I just put them in so that we see what's the idea here. And at this point, we can use the triangle inequality again. Namely, this is smaller than or equal to, so triangle inequality. An minus a to the absolute value plus bn minus b to the absolute value. And since we're bigger than n0, we are both bigger than n1 and n2, which means we are in both of these situations. So this is in fact smaller than, so the first one is smaller than epsilon half, and the second one as well. So we can estimate it from above by epsilon over 2 plus epsilon over 2, and magically this gives epsilon. So we found for any given epsilon, we have constructed an n0 such that this is smaller than epsilon for all n bigger than or equal to n0. And this is precisely the definition of convergence. And since epsilon was arbitrary, it was just some number, some positive number, this shows the convergence. So this shows that limit n to infinity an plus bn is in fact a plus b. Okay, and the proof for the multiplication with some constant factor is similar. It's again, we do a little funny epsilon trick, namely the following. First of all, we have two cases. First one is the trivial one, if c is equal to 0. Yeah, what happens then? Then the whole sequence becomes zero when we multiply, so it's a constant sequence. Of course it converges, and the limit is zero, so there's nothing to show. If c is equal to zero, obvious. So we assume c is not equal to zero in what is to come. Okay, if we make this simple assumption, we again start the same way. We have some epsilon bigger than zero. Then there exists a number. Let me just call it n3 to just separate this from the other n's so you don't get distracted here in the same proof by the different names here. So we have some n3 in n such that, and this is just by convergence, an minus a to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon divided by the absolute value of c. Since c is not zero, this absolute value is not zero, so this is indeed well defined. So that this holds for all n at least n3. And again, we've just started with an arbitrary positive number and just modified this a bit to get some other positive number. And by convergence, we always can find such an n3. And of course, why do we do this? We will see, because it works. Namely, then we get, so we want to estimate this difference c times an minus c times a to the absolute value. Of course, by distributivity, this is the same as the value of c times, and then in parentheses, an minus a. And since absolute value behaves very nicely with products, with respect to products, this is the absolute value of c times the value of an minus a. And if now n is big enough, if n is now bigger than n3, we can use this estimate. So we get that this is smaller than c times epsilon, absolute value of c times epsilon divided by the absolute value over c. And now we can see why we did this, because this now gives epsilon, and this holds for n for all n at least n3. So again, with this little trick here, we've seen that this works. So of course, this is some proof kind of in the beginning when you kind of choose your epsilon in such a strange way. You cannot see why, and you only see this in hindsight. And this is something you need to understand about these calculus proofs. Like if it starts in this awkward way, so we do this strange thing with epsilon over 2 or whatever we do with our epsilon, this is basically done by reverse engineering. People kind of looked at the computation and see, okay, how do we need to choose our constants so things work? And then you do this. So it's at this point, it's clear that you cannot just understand what happens directly. So this is normal. So don't worry about the structure of these proofs. It's somehow you just need to get used to it. So this shows, hence, the limit of c times a n is the same as c times a. And yeah, this completes the proof of this theorem. So we've seen in this way, behaves nicely, and I want to just include one observation that we can draw from this already, because this is often used in proofs indirectly without kind of really noting that this really holds. Namely, we get from this theorem immediately that in general, in this, I don't write where the sequence is, so we have some sequence in the field K, I don't write this again. The limit of a sequence is A, if and only if the limit of from n to infinity of a n minus a is 0. This is something you can either see explicitly from the convergence definition, but here it follows, since we can just here subtract a on both sides and then view a as a constant sequence, and so multiplying with a minus is compatible with the limit by part b, and then taking the sum inside is compatible hereby with limits by part a. So this really shows this equivalence, and this is kind of some statement that is used quite frequently. Okay, another property of convergent sequences. For this, I need to introduce another definition, so another term. Namely, that again, k be the real numbers or the complex numbers, it works in both cases. A sequence a n in k is called bounded if there exists some constant c, which is a non-negative real number, some c bigger than or equal to 0, with such that the absolute value of an is at most c for every n in n. So if you recall that in the real numbers, so we kind of know that this is basically every number is contained is between minus c and c somewhere. And in the complex numbers, recall that this value is kind of the length of the vector in R2. So this means kind of the length is at most c of every vector. So this is why bounded is kind of intuitively means it stays in some bounded part of the real numbers or the complex numbers. And a sequence which is not bounded is called unbounded. Unbounded. Okay, and this has a direct connection to convergence, definition theorem 2.10. Again, k is r or k is c. Then every convergent sequence in k is bounded. Okay, every convergent sequence is bounded. For the proof, I need some more space, so I will quickly erase. Okay, we start with the convergent sequence that an be a convergent sequence in K, and we denote its limit of an as a. Okay, so we need to show that this is bounded, and this is actually simpler than you might think. Namely, we now just don't need all these epsilons, we just take one particular epsilon. Namely, we just consider epsilon equal to 1. And then, by definition of convergence, there exists some number n0 in n, such that an minus a to the absolute value is smaller than 1 for all n at least n0. Okay, now from this fact we can already derive a nice estimate for the absolute value of an for all these big n, namely in the following way. This is again simply the triangle inequality. Namely, we get the absolute value of an. This can be written in an unnecessarily complicated way by an minus a plus a, and here we go with the triangle inequality. So the absolute value of an minus a plus the absolute value of a, and this is estimated by 1, so this is smaller than 1 plus the absolute value of a for all n at least n0. And so this is just some fixed number, we don't care, but it's just a fixed upper bound. So all but the first n0 minus 1 are estimated by this. So to estimate everything, we just need to include bounds for the first n0 minus 1s. And this is simple because they are only finitely many, and of course you can find a bound for them. Namely, we simply put C, which is supposed to be our fancy upper bound, the maximum of the following. We take the absolute value of A1, the absolute value of A2, and so on, and the absolute value of AN0 minus 1. So this we need to just get a bound for the first n0 minus 1, and for the remaining ones we just need this. Okay, and this is, of course, this is a maximum of finitely many elements. This is well defined, so this is really just some number. And then by definition, the absolute value of an is smaller than or equal to c for all n in n. And this is boundedness. So this shows that an n in n is bounded. Okay, so we know that every convergent sequence is bounded. So to show that a sequence is not convergent, it suffices to show that it's not bounded, because that is necessary to have convergence. And this is what we can use for a nice example. Okay, this should be number 211. Namely, we've already seen, there's basically one sequence that we've seen in another case. Oops. Namely, we consider the sequence q to the power of n, n in n. There we've seen in the last video that if the absolute value of q is strictly smaller than 1, then this converges to 0. Now we can consider another case. Namely, we can see what happens if q is in C with absolute value bigger than 1, then it's too big. And the idea is kind of that this now, then the absolute value of this will become too big, as you can easily see. Namely, so we want to show that this sequence is unbounded. So we need to show that this here gets out of control, so that this cannot be bounded from above by any fixed number. And this is not that hard to see, and maybe you just use a little trick. So this is the same as this, since absolute value behaves well with products. Now, since we write this now a bit differently by just writing 1 plus q to the absolute value minus 1 to the power of n. And since this number here is yeah, by definition bigger than 0, or the important thing is that it's bigger than minus 1, namely we can at this point use the Bernoulli inequality. This is bigger than or equal to by Bernoulli's inequality. Oops. One plus n times the absolute value of q minus 1. So this is just some positive number. And then we see if n, we know that n is unbounded, and so this is what follows, that if n becomes very, very, very big, this whole thing becomes unbounded. So, yeah, this sequence is unbounded. And so from the previous theorem, which says that every conversion sequence is bounded, shows that every every conversion sequence is bounded, which means in the converse that if a sequence is unbounded, it cannot converge. So by theorem 2.10, q to the n, n in n is divergent. Okay, so much for this example. Too many sheets. And also, just another very simple thing, just something that you might not mistake. The converse of theorem 2.10 is false. Namely, we know that every conversion sequence is bounded, but not every bounded sequence is convergent. And we already have seen an example of this, namely minus 1 to the n as a sequence here over n. This is bounded. This alternates between the values 1 and minus 1. So this is bounded, but not convergent. It's divergent. So this is important. Convergent implies boundedness, but not the other way around. Okay, now we come to products. Let me arrange the blackboards here conveniently. So, okay. Theorem 2.12. Again, k equal to r or c. And we have an and bn sequences in k. Bn, n in n, sequences in k. Okay, so the first step. If an is bounded and bn converges to zero, then it follows that the product an times bn, seen as a sequence here over n, that this converges to zero as well. But it's important, as we will see in the counterexample in a bit, that this sequence here must really be bounded. So if it just stays in the range and the other one really goes down to zero, everything goes to zero. Then part B, if an converges to some element A and Bn converges to some element B, then it follows that the product An times Bn as a sequence converges to the product of the limits. Okay. So this is the behavior of this product. You might wonder why it doesn't do it this way around. In fact, we will really need A to prove B, as we will see in a bit. But here it's just for A, we need to note that so this has to be bounded, but An itself does not have to converge. That's an interesting observation here. Okay, let's prove this. Okay, part A, so An is bounded, so we just take ourselves a bound. C bigger than or equal to zero, such that an to the absolute value is smaller than or equal to c for all n in n. And now we again take some epsilon bigger than zero. Okay, and now we need, so this was for the boundedness, now we need the convergence. Since Bn, n in n, converges to zero, there exists an n0 in n such that the absolute value of this would be Bn minus zero, so just Bn, is smaller than epsilon for all n, oh wait, sorry, sorry. Again, we want to do this funny trick. Epsilon over C. This is again a positive constant, so we can find some n0 for all n bigger than or equal to n0. Okay, but then we're almost done, because then we know that the product an times bn to the absolute value, we need to show that this becomes smaller than epsilon. This is the same as the absolute value of an times the absolute value of bn. Now we can just combine these two estimates. So here the first factor is bounded by c, the second one by epsilon over c if n is big enough. So this is then strictly smaller than c times epsilon over c, which magically gives epsilon. And this holds for all n bigger than or equal to n0. So this might escalate a bit in the lecture. So we might have some strange choices of epsilons, and you might also be confused at this moment. It might look like something very fancy. Actually, there's even a meme about this, which I will show you now. Okay. So this shows part A, and for part B, we can really use part A. Namely, part B. So we have, this time we have two conversion sequences. We converge to some numbers a and, a and b and want to study the product of them. Okay, we now first define as a new sequence, namely we put cn is defined as bn minus b for all n and n. And we've seen since bn converges to b, it's not on the board anymore, I think, but then it follows that this is a zero, that this sequence converges to zero. So limit n to infinity of cn is equal to zero. And by this remark from before. And since an is convergent, particularly follows from the theorem before, theorem 210, that an is bounded. And this shows that the product of an with cn, with this new sequence here, that this converges to zero by part A. So using part A, we get that limit of from n to infinity of an times cn is equal to zero. Okay, what does this help us? Now we can just do a nice computation. So the limit of n to infinity an times bn. This is what we want to have. And to get back to cn, we just make a kind of pointless looking expansion of this. This is limit n to infinity of an times bn minus b plus an times b. Okay, yeah, not too interesting. But now we can use this sum law for limits, the sum rule that we have proven. The Bose theorem, okay, I've written down a number, but this is definitely the wrong one. That was theorem 2.7. Okay, by this theorem, limit behaves well with respect to sums. So we get that this is the limit from n to infinity of an times, and this is, of course, cn. So we get that this is the limit of an times cn plus limit n to infinity, so this is theorem 2.7a that we've used here, limit of an times b, and now here this b is a fixed constant, so we have seen this is zero, and so this gives us by theorem 2.7b, we've seen multiplication with constants doesn't matter. So this is the same as limit n to infinity an, and this in parentheses, times b, and this is a times b. Sorry, I hope it's still readable, but this shows really that in this way, we get that the limit of this product is the product of limits here, and this is what we wanted to show. So here we are done. Okay, so good news. Limits behave well with respect to products and with respect to sums, so we can do many nice computations and use limits in a nice way. And we will see in a few weeks that limits also have some other nice properties with other, they're compatible with many things. But this will take a while. Okay, let me just erase. Before we go on, a little example which shows that this one assumption in part A of the previous theorem was necessary. Namely, we have seen in part A of the previous theorem, let me just get the numbering right, it was 213. We have seen that the product of a bounded sequence and a sequence converging to zero converges to zero. But I just want to argue that boundedness is really important here. So the boundedness of AN is really necessary in theorem 212a. And I will just give you a counterexample in the unbounded case. Namely, it's a very simple example. We consider an equal to n squared and bn equal to 1 over n for all n in n. Okay, it doesn't get more simple than that. So we see bn converges to 0, this we've already seen, and this here is unbounded. This n squared explodes when n becomes very big. An unbounded, bn goes to 0, converges to 0, and the product of the two, so the sequence an times bn, n in n, so n squared times n, 1 over n, this is of course simply the sequence n. N in n, and we've seen that the natural numbers are unbounded, so this is unbounded, so it doesn't converge at all. In particular, it doesn't converge to zero, so hence divergent. So the boundedness is really crucial at this point. Okay. Now we've seen sums, we've seen products. Now there's one thing left which we still need to investigate, namely quotients, to get some nice little computations in the real in the complex numbers or the real numbers. Theorem 214. Again, we are in the real numbers or the complex numbers. And we have a sequence in K. And we need to assume that, we want to study the quotients 1 over an. And to do this, of course, we need to ensure that an is not 0 for all n in n. Okay, if the sequence an itself converges with limit, this we call A, and if also A is not equal to 0, then the sequence of quotients 1 over AN, N and N, converges, and the limit is then precisely what we want it to be, with limit N to infinity of 1 over AN is 1 over A. So also this works well. Okay, this we want to show. Okay, and of course to show this, a reminder, we want to show that, which is equivalent by this remark I had before, that the difference 1 over an minus 1 over a, that this converges to 0. Which is, of course, equivalent. Okay, let's study the sequence in more detail. So, compute 1 over an minus 1 over a. Let's bring this onto the same denominator. Then we get, this is the same as a minus an divided by an a. Okay, this we write as a product. This is 1 over an a times a minus an. And we know that since an converges to a, we know that the limit n to infinity of a minus an, this is just by putting minus 1 outside the limit, minus the limit n to infinity of a n minus a, and this is 0, as we've seen before. Since this is a 0, a n converges to a, so this converges to 0. So this is a 0 sequence, and we've just seen that the product of a sequence converging to 0 with a bounded sequence gives a sequence converging to 0. So since this is the case, it suffices to show that this factor here is bounded. Then we're done. Then we know that this converges to 0. So it suffices to show that 1 over ANA as a sequence indexed by n is bounded. So, and here we've used theorem 210, was it? 210. No, sorry. Messed up my numbering. 212. 212A. Okay, so this boundedness, this is what we want to prove. So first of all, just a little trick, by convergence of an, this time we again pick a nice epsilon that is useful for all purposes and find a suitable n0. By convergence of an, there exists an n0 in n such that the difference an minus a is smaller than the absolute value of a over 2 for all n at least n0. Since a is non-zero, this is just some positive number, so we can always find this. Okay, yes, this is what we have. And now we need to do some nice computations, namely, again, the triangle inequality, which we use over and over and over again in this course. So by the triangle inequality, we know that a, the absolute value of a, is smaller than or equal to the value of a minus an plus the value of an. This is simply by subtracting and adding an and then using the triangle inequality. So this holds, and this is then, maybe I'll continue on the other blackboard. And just by playing around with this inequality, we simply get that an, so absolute value of an, is bigger than or equal to the absolute value of a minus an minus a for all n in n. But now we can use the estimate that we had here, namely if n is big enough for all n at least n0, we get that an is bigger than a minus 1 half of a, which is the absolute value of a over 2. Very simple. So because here we've just used that the minus sign flips the direction of the inequality. So since we have this, we know that the absolute value of 1 over a and a, which is what we need to be bounded, that this, which is of course the same as 1 divided by the absolute value of a n times absolute value of a. Now if we kind of use the reverse of this inequality, this is smaller than 2 divided by absolute value of a squared. And this for all n bigger than n0. And now we can use a similar trick. So we've seen that almost every element of the sequence is bounded by this fixed number here. So if we put, again, it's basically the same trick as before, c to be the maximum of the first n0 minus 1 terms that can happen here, so 1 over the absolute value of a1a, 1 over the absolute value of a2a, and so on, until 1 over the absolute value of a n0 minus 1a, and finally 2 over absolute value of a squared, then the absolute value of 1 over a and a is at most c for all n in n. So the sequence 1 over a and a is bounded. and now we're done, because we've already seen, it suffices to show at this point, where are we? Here, it suffices to show that this is bounded, since then we can use this theorem from before, and then we're done. So this indeed shows the claim. So we've seen it behaves well with respect to quotients, and now we can derive a nice equality, which we've actually already proven, but I want to have this explicitly on the board once. And the remark 215. By the previous two theorems, so theorems 212 and 214, so one was about products, one about quotients. I just write in case of convergence. I know you think you can figure out what it means. If we then have the limit from n to infinity of an divided by bn, so if we now take this as a product of an with 1 over bn, this is the same by the previous two theorems as the limit of an divided by the limit of bn. Okay, this is a nice formula that we can really use. So this works, this works with respect to sums and so on, and this is a nice computational rule here. Before I proceed with some more theory, I just want to line out an example and the strategy of how to tackle things. Namely, we take the following sequence. An is, and now something very explicit, 3n squared plus 5 divided by n squared plus 1, where n in n. Okay, now there's a problem, because we cannot just simply use this rule, because it doesn't converge. If we take the sequence in the numerator here, we have 3n squared plus 5, this is unbounded, this becomes infinitely big, so it doesn't converge, and the same goes for the denominator. So this rule directly doesn't help. But we can now use a little trick, namely we can reduce the fraction. Reduce fractions. Namely, we just take that this is n squared times 3 plus 5 divided by n squared in the numerator, and we do the same in the denominator, where we get this is n squared times 1 plus 1 divided by n squared, and now we can cancel the n squared and get that this is the same as 1 plus 5 over n squared, 3 plus 5 over n squared divided by 1 plus 1 over n squared. And now we're in a different situation. Now this converges. We see that 5 over n squared and 1 over n squared, they obviously go to 0. I've already shown this, but this goes to 0. And so this is constant, this is constant, so we can see what happens. Namely here, I just noticed I did something I haven't proven yet, actually. I have to still, I just realized. Let me just add this. I will do a formal proof of this later on of a more general thing, but the limit of 1 over n squared, this is the same as limit n to infinity of 1 over n times 1 over n. And we've seen that 1 over n converges to 0. So this is, in particular, the case of a bounded sequence times a sequence converging to 0. So this is, again, 0 by the theorem from above. So these guys here go to 0. And here we get, since now both converge, we can use this rule here to get that the limit of n to infinity of the sequence an. So this is then limit of 3 plus 5 over n squared, n to infinity, divided by limit n to infinity of 1 plus 1 over n squared. And now to do this really formally, you don't need to do this every time in the homework or something, but we know that limit behaves well with respect to sums. So this is very explicitly the same as limit n goes to infinity of the constant sequence 3 plus limit n to infinity of 5 over n squared divided by limit n to infinity of the constant sequence 1 plus limit n to infinity of the constant sequence, of the sequence 1 over n squared. And so this is 0, this is 0, this is 3, this is 1. This gives 3 over 1, which is 3. So here we've got the limit. Okay, and let me quickly erase. So this was an example of a sequence where we have powers of n occurring in the numerator and the denominator, and there is a general strategy for these things. So we have seen we reduce the fraction, but of course the question is reducing the fraction by what? And so I just want to give you a strategy without further examples, but instead you will see some exercises where you can really practice this. So the strategy for such sequences is usually the reduce the fractions. I'll reduce fraction by the highest power of n of n that occurs in the denominator. You might not always get convergence, but if you do this, you will have usually see what happens, or if the sequence converges or diverges. I'm not telling you details on this, but you will then show this yourself in some exercises. Okay, so much for this example. Now we take a look at another phenomenon, which is also, at the moment it's only theoretically interesting, but this will have lots of applications later on. So, very general, let X be a set, and that AN be a sequence in X. So this is, again, something which is not relying on R or K, but just very general in some arbitrary sequence somewhere. Another sequence, BK, K in N, is called a subsequence of the sequence AN. So BK is, again, a sequence in X. And it's a subsequence of AN if, and this now might look a bit mysterious, and I will tell you some examples in a moment, if there is a map phi from N to N with which is ordered, namely with phi of 1 is strictly smaller than phi of 2, strictly smaller than phi of 3, and so on. And so that this goes on, so that phi of k is smaller than phi of k plus 1 for k, and so on. So this really keeps the ordering. So this means we go from n back into n, but we might leave out some things. We keep the order, but we might leave out some numbers. That's the main idea here. And if there's such a map phi, which is kind of a procedure of leaving out numbers, such that bk is A of phi of k for all k in n. Okay, and usually one denotes this a bit differently. In this case, one usually puts put nk, I define as phi of k, denote the subsequence by ank indexed by k in n. So we just take the element ank for each k, and this means we take elements of a, we preserve the, of an, we preserve the ordering, but we might leave out some elements of an. We don't take every element. And before I go on, let me just give you some examples. So example 218. First of all, the sequence 1 over n squared, indexed by n and n, is a subsequence of the sequence 1 over n. So this means we don't take all of the 1 over n, but only those which are squares of numbers. Right? So here we take phi of n is equal to n squared. So this would correspond to this subsequence. This means like maybe, so we have, let me just make a small list here. So the sequence 1 over n starts with 1, then 1 half, 1 third, 1 fourth, 1 fifth, 1 sixth, 1 seventh, 1 eighth, 1 ninth, and so on. And so taking the subsequence then means that we just choose some elements of the sequence. So we only choose those where there's a square in the denominator. This means we would start with 1, that would be n equal to 1. For n equal to 2, we will get the square of 2, which is 4, so we will take this one here. And the next one we would choose would be this one, because it is 3 squared in the denominator. The next one would be 1 over 16, and so on, and so on, and so on. So we just pick some elements out of our sequence. Okay, so this is an example of a subsequence. So this just as a side remark. Secondly, the constant sequence. Which is constant just 1, indexed by n and n, is a subsequence of the sequence minus 1 to the n, n and n. So here we see that all the odd, for odd n we get minus 1, for even n we get plus 1, so we just need to take every even element. So this means our phi would look the following way, phi of n is 2n. We just take those elements of the sequence with index of the form 2n, and they are of course all equal to 1. And this is a phi, these two phis really are maps which have this thing, so the ordering is preserved, and this is what happens here. Another example, just to go into the complex numbers again. Now we take minus 1 to the n, n in n. This is a subsequence of the sequence I to the n, n in n. So to find phi, let us just think about what the sequence looks like. So we get I to the power of 1 is just I. This is, we had this example before, let me just give it again. I squared is minus 1, I to the 3 is then minus I, and I to the 4 is plus 1, and then we start over again, we get I minus 1 minus I 1. And now if we see this, to get minus 1 to the n, this means we have to, so with n equal to 1, we would get minus 1, then n equal to plus 1, and so on. So we just, here it goes on, of course. This is not, so this pattern repeats again and again. So we just need to take this one, and this one, and this one, and this one, and so on, and so on. And this shows that, if we just again have the same as here, phi of n is 2n. Right? Just the, those with even index. So these are examples of subsequences. Now, subsequences have a nice property with respect to convergence, which is what we want to study next. So theorem 219, that again, K be the real numbers or the complex numbers. An be a sequence which converges as a convergent sequence in K. And we denote its limit by A again. So the limit of an is a, then every subsequence of the sequence converges against a as well. Okay? This just makes sense because like if the sequence converges to A means that everything approaches A. And so if we take just some subset, so some subsequence, but we still follow this ordering and still follow kind of the same lines, just leaving out some elements, we still approximate the same value. It's just, yeah, we just take this some pieces out of this. And to prove this formally, it's a little computation. Okay, we take a subsequence that A and K, where K and N be a subsequence. So we particularly get that the indices are ordered. So this means N1 is smaller than N2, is smaller than N3. Okay, so they are kind of increasing number of natural numbers and increasing sequence of natural numbers. So, but then we know that since if this is kind of the third one in the sequence, this is the kth one, and so on, we know since we might leave some out, but we don't skip some of them, so we can't squeeze this together, we know that nk has to be at least k, because otherwise we can't have, I mean, they have to be k minus one numbers before, so we don't know what precisely the value of nk is, but it has to be k or bigger. Right? So this means then nk is at least k for all k and n. This is just some standard observation. Okay, now we need our little epsilon again. So let epsilon bigger than zero just be a constant number. By assumption, we know that an converges. So there's a number which this time I call k0 instead of n0, just because I can. because this is more convenient in a bit. So there exists a k0 in n such that a n minus a to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon for all n at least k0. Then, for all k bigger than k0, we obtain the following. We obtain that nk is at least k, which is at least k0. So this particularly means that if we're beyond this k0, that for every k bigger than k0, we get, a and k minus a is smaller than epsilon for all k bigger than or equal to k0. So given epsilon, we found a k0 such that every element of the subsequence, which is further than k0, is epsilon close to a, and this shows convergence. This is just simply convergence. Since epsilon was arbitrary, this shows the claim. Okay, now as a final thing for this paragraph, for this section, I just want to kind of connect the convergence in the complex numbers and the one in the real numbers, because as we know, complex numbers are simply pairs of real numbers connected by this imaginary unit. But of course, if we have a complex sequence, if we take it the real parts and the imaginary parts of this sequence, then we get real sequences. So how is the convergence of a complex sequence related to the convergence of these real sequences? And it turns out, and this is what we kind of would expect to not mess up our computations, that these are basically the same, as we will see in this theorem. So we take a sequence of complex numbers, I will call Cn, be a complex sequence, and I write these elements as Cn is An plus Ibn, where An and Bn are real numbers, so the real and imaginary part, for all n and n, and that C be some complex number, which then should be our limit, which we write as A plus IB in C. Okay, then Cn, the sequence here, converges to C if and only if the real part and the imaginary parts converge. So an n in n converges to A and Bn n in n converges to B. Okay, so these are really connected, and this is kind of a relief because otherwise you would have to be really careful working with real and imaginary parts, but this shows us that this is really not the case. Okay, let me quickly erase and then we do the proof. The proof is not too hard, we just need some standard computations with complex numbers. Namely, we start with a simpler direction. We assume the convergence of the complex sequence and want to show the convergence of the real sequence associated with it. So, let epsilon bigger than zero, then we know it exists n0 in n such that cn minus c to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon for all n equal to n0 or bigger. Okay, then it follows. Namely, we can see if we now take a look at the difference a n minus a, so this is what we also want to estimate. This is the same as the real part of cn minus c. This is basically very elementary. This you can just easily see. But we know, and this was part of our results on complex numbers, on the absolute value of complex numbers, that was theorem 173 part c, that the absolute value of the real part of a number is always smaller than or equal to the value of the number itself, and this is smaller than epsilon if n is big enough. And the same goes for the imaginary part, which means that bn minus b, which is easily seen to be the imaginary part of cn minus c, both in the absolute value here, is smaller than or equal to cn minus c smaller than epsilon, and this in both cases for all n bigger than or equal to n0, but this already shows convergence. Since we have found our n0 to for this epsilon, like accidentally we can just take the same n0 in both cases, which is irrelevant for us, since this just both shows that this is really convergence. So here we get that the limit n to infinity a n is a, and same for the bn, limit n to infinity bn is b. Okay. For the other direction, it's actually much more complicated. We just need to include one additional computation. So here we now assume that an and bn are convergent. And we know that the real and the imaginary parts converge. There we need just one little property that I think I haven't mentioned so far in the lecture before. Some little computation for complex numbers, because for every complex number z and c, we compute that the absolute value of z. So we can write z in an unnecessarily complicated way as the real part of z plus I times the imaginary part of z. But now we can use, or we can view this one and this one kind of as individual complex numbers and use the triangle inequality. So this is smaller than or equal to, again, by the triangle inequality, which we're using for the thousandth time, I think. By the absolute value of the real part of z plus the absolute value of I times the imaginary part of z. And this we can further simplify. This is the same as, continue on the next blackboard. This is the same as the absolute value of the real part of z plus the absolute value of I times the absolute value of the imaginary part of z. And as you can easily see from the definition of absolute value, the absolute value of I is 1. This is just a simple computation. So what we get here is that the absolute value of z is smaller than or equal to the value of the real part of z plus the value, amazing layout here, I'm sorry, plus the absolute value of the imaginary part of z. Okay, let's give this a star so I can quote it in when I will use this in a second. So now we know that an and bn are convergent. Let me do it like this. So given epsilon bigger than zero, we know that from some element on, the an and the bn's will be close to their limits, but the two values might be different. So we know that there exists n1, n2 in n, such that
an minus a to the value is smaller than epsilon for all n at least n1. And there is some n2 such that bn minus b is smaller than epsilon. I want to do the good old trick again. I want to choose it in such a way that this is smaller than epsilon over 2. Again, the same trick. So I'm doing this because I can do it, but we will see, we'll see in a second why this works then. And so that this here holds for all n at least n2. And now it's almost the same as what we did with the sums of sequences. We again put n0 to be the bigger of the two numbers, so the maximum of n1 and n2. Then for all n at least n0, we get that cn minus c. This is then by this inequality star smaller than or equal to the sum of the value of the real part and the imaginary part. But we know, as we've seen in the previous part already, that the real part of this is just an minus a, and the imaginary part is just bn minus b. So this is precisely what we have chosen our n0 for, namely this is now smaller than epsilon over 2 plus epsilon over 2, and hooray, we get epsilon. So this shows, so for all epsilon, we have found an n0 such that this is smaller than epsilon if n is bigger than n0, and this shows the convergence. So this implies that the limit for n to infinity cn is c. This concludes the proof. So just to write this down once again, we can have this nice formula for the limits there. So this is something that you can easily memorize, and this is what I want to finish with. So remark, what is it? This was our theorem 220, so this is 221. So I just write in case of convergence. Theorem 220 yields that the limit of the sequence cn is the same as the limit of an plus I times the limit of bn. So this is a form which we can memorize. Okay. This is all I want to show. So now we've got all computational properties for limits collected. And in the next section, we will focus on sequences of real numbers and to see that there we can really use the ordering of the real numbers to handle some nice inequalities to get convergence properties for these sequences. And we will see quite some examples in the next section. Okay, so see you in the next video.